Alright, let's take it from the top one more time. My name is Scotty. I review movies and play video games. You know the rest. I'm sorry, that's how they introduce themselves in this movie. Spider-Man, enter the Spider-Verse. Into the Spider-Verse. I was getting messed up. Into the Spider-Verse, the last, currently the last, of the Spider-Man movies I'm going through for the Spider-Man review series. Like I said, the other two are going to be part of the cinematic MCU rankings. MCU review series, I mean. So, yeah. Alright, so this is a different Spider-Man movie than what you're used to. Peter Parker is not the main character. Miles Morales is. Alright? And one night, while in the subway, for some reason, I think he was doing graffiti, he stumbles across Spider-Man fighting against the Kingpin, and some Kingpin has some machine. And the machine activates, Spider-Man is killed by the Kingpin, and Miles finds himself to blame. Also, he's bit by a spider that is changed by the machine, I think. But it gives him spider powers, not like the regular Spider-Man powers. He can turn invisible and also shoot electricity from his hands, which is pretty cool. Different. Miles is enrolled in the Visions program, which is some like private school thing. His dad's a cop. You know, you've seen the scene in the trailer where he's, you gotta say I love you. Pushing a little too far there, Dad. Would I do that to my son? Probably. What? Not saying I wouldn't, but I might. Sorry. So after Spider-Man's funeral, everything, you know, Miles realizes he has these powers, and he can't control them. And he's at Peter Parker's grave, because Peter Parker is outed as Spider-Man in this version after the death. So Peter Parker is at Peter Parker's grave, and he's visited by Peter Parker. Peter B. Parker. From an alternate universe where he got fat. I'm assuming that Peter B. Parker is actually our Peter Parker. Because the Peter Parker in this version was younger, had blonde hair. Just, I don't think that's our Peter Parker. I think Peter B. Parker is supposed to be our Peter. You know? Our Spider-Man. I don't know. He meets this girl named Gwanda. Which is actually Gwen Stacy, if you're not stupid, you figure that out. He realizes what happened was, when the machine went off, it opened a doorway to many different alternate dimensions. And brought forth different spider people. Gwen Stacy, Penny Parker and her spider-powered robot, Spider-Noir, also Peter Parker, the Peter B. Parker, Peter Porker, a.k.a. Spider-Ham, and that's it, actually. Yeah. And that's a little bit later in the film, though, because he starts to work with Peter B. Parker to get the information so they can get I have not been yawning at all this morning. And yet, I can't stop yawning in this review. Okay, so they go to this lab to get it's a computer, but it's just the main part, not the modem, the monitor. I don't remember what it's called. It's not modem. I don't know. I don't remember what it's called, but it's just the box with the information and stuff in it. And I see this doctor lady. She's revealed to be Olivia Octavius. This world's version of Dr. Octopus, which is why I think this isn't our Earth, because Dr. Octopus is a female. The Kingpin's family, you know, his wife and his son Richard, are dead. They died in some sort of accident. As a result of the Kingpin being obsessed with Spider-Man, there's a scorpion. The scorpion is in this, but he's Mexican, which I don't know if he's ever been. Because Matt Gargan, I don't know if he's Mexican, but okay. And then you got Tombstone. Damn it! Stop yawning! Don't know why I can't stop yawning. Tombstone. It's the last word I said. Tombstone is in this. And no yawning. Tombstone is in this. And this is going to be hard to get through because I can't stop freaking yawning. I'm going to down a caffeinated drink before the next one. I'm going to take a shower too. Here's this thing. But, Tombstone's in this. So, after the encounter with Dr. Octopus, they're saved by Gwen, and they realize the only place to go is to Aunt May's house, where she reveals that Peter, this version of Peter, had a special, it was a shed, but it was like a hideout. And that's where it's revealed that the other three, Penny Parker, Spider-Ham, and Spider-Noir, are there. And Peter B. Parker tries to get the rest of them to agree to have Miles help. Because Miles has powers, but he can't control them yet. So, they decide, well, no, we're going to go do it ourselves. And Peter B. Parker is going to be the one to... Because they'd have to have someone push the button and stay there. And they're glitching out. And they can't stay there for long because they're glitching out. So, if he stays there, he could die. Well, right after, you know, he has a confrontation and stuff, he says, no, you can't do it. You don't have control of your powers, you can't do it. After this happens, he gains control of his powers. It's like, okay, you gotta boost him, but why can't you just have him be able to control his powers when he was? You gotta have to, I don't know. Little side plot, I forgot to mention, Aaron Davis is a character. Donald Glover played him in Spider-Man Homecoming. And this one, I don't remember who the actor was. I really don't remember. But Mahershala Ali, I think it was. He's really close. He and Aaron are really... Aaron and Miles are really close. It's his uncle. And I remember when I first watched this with my son, because I didn't go to theaters to see this. My son and I watched this for the first time together, alright? And, I didn't get to see it, like, right on the screen until now, because I had to let the dog out, or in, one of the two. And I come back, and he goes, my son's like, his uncle's the bad guy. What? And I look, and he's like, My uncle's the Prowler. The Prowler. If I knew, I didn't know that was the Prowler. If I knew that was the Prowler, then I would have known it was his uncle, but I didn't know it was the Prowler. I know what the Prowler looked like. It's like, I don't know. It's just, I just don't know. There was a, I forgot, there was a post-credit scene at the end of Venom. There was a scene from this, and I totally forgot, totally spaced it, totally spaced it. But, yeah. So, Miles gets a new suit with help from Aunt May, I believe. I was using the restroom at the time, but I believe that's how it happens. And, you know, it's the that suit. Because he was wearing a store-bought Spider-Man suit like that for most of it. Why is it in superhero origin stories, they're not allowed to wear their actual suits until the climax of the film, is what it seems like, you know? Or they're not allowed, you know? Because, you see, like, there's not everyone, but there's, like, you know, how can I explain this? They're not allowed to be the superhero of the movie until the climax. They did this with the 2017 Power Rangers movies on Sci-Fi last night, right? Why did they do that with some of those these movies? All right, the movie is called Power Rangers, and they don't become Power Rangers till the climax of the film. That's what bugged me. I'm like, and I said, but I was going. I'm like, I want them to have their Power Ranger powers throughout the entire film, not just the climax. And exactly what they did was give it to them just at the climax. The whole thing was like at some weird CW drama until the final act when it finally became Power Rangers. It was a CW superhero show, you know, superhero series with Power Rangers elements until they finally became Power Rangers at the end. And I'm talking about Power Rangers, this is Spider-Man. I should wait till I do the review, because I'm going to do a review for all the Power Rangers movies too. But, and that's one of the biggest problems of that movie was. So, Miles has to run around, my problem is Miles has to run around with a fake-ass Spider-Man suit until the end when he finally gets this suit and becomes the hero. That's why I don't like origin stories, alright? Just have them be the hero right out, alright? Now, most origin stories, like the Sam Raimi Spider-Man movie, he gets the Spider-Man suit, I want to say, almost halfway. He becomes the actual Spider-Man and fighting and stuff. It doesn't take to the end. But, still. Same thing with the Amazing Spider-Man, alright? But, again, in Spider-Man Homecoming, they do a backwards thing. They do it backwards. They still have him earn his suit. You know, he gets the suit in Civil War, so that there's that, and he has the suit. But it's taken away from him before the climax. Then he has to wear that janky-ass homemade suit. And then in the end, he's giving the suit back. It's like, what's the point? Why have a climax where he's not wearing the actual Spider-Man suit that's on the freaking poster, on the freaking Blu-ray, on the freaking DVD? No. I don't like that. And I also didn't like the Iron Spider suit either. And yeah. So anyway, back to this. Because that's what we're talking about. Enough of my ranting. How was I? Yeah, so Miles shows up to help the rest of them take down the Kingpin. And the Kingpin, you know, and there's Kingpin and Tombstone and Scorpion and Dr. Octopus, Doc Ock, whatever. Liv. And so he gets that thing in there. Turns it's a little key. You know, earlier in the film, Spider-Man, Peter B. Parker said, keep your eyes on the hands, not the eyes on the mouth, or whatever. And so then he says the same thing and takes the thing from him, and the machine sends everyone back except for Peter B. Parker, who decides he's staying to help him, but he goes back because he feels like a failure because his marriage with Mary Jane failed, and he's a bum, basically. But, you know, Miles has given him the courage to continue, and he sends him back. Miles takes down the Kingpin eventually. Kingpin seems to, like really batter and bruise him. And he sees his father. Miles sees his father standing in the console thing. And he's going, come on, Spider-Man. This is kind of like a throwback to Homecoming. He's like, come on, Spider-Man. Which, I'm not familiar with the comics, but Miles Morales is not Spider-Man. He's Kid Arachnid, isn't he? Isn't that what he's called? Kid Arachnid? Not Spider-Man? I don't know. But, for the purpose of this movie being called Spider-Man, if they do a sequel, they need to call it Kid Arachnid, because I think that's what he's called. I'm not 100% sure. Let me know in the comments. But it was on the toy that my son got. My son has Miles Morales' toy. All those big ones. And I swear it said Kid Arachnid. But, anyway, so Miles is down, his father's yelling, come on, Spider-Man, and he uses his electricity to, you know, and he pushed the button, bought me in it, throws the button, shuts everything down, and all that, and, yeah. Some other things at the end, but it's not really important to tell. I already spoiled the best part. There is a post-credits scene. It shows Miguel O'Hara, a.k.a. Spider-Man 2099, in the universe of the 1967 Spider-Man cartoon. Just a little thing there. Yeah. And from what I read, they're planning on sequels and spin-offs for this. Something's got to make money, you know? But with Tom Holland, with, you know, the Spider-Man getting, with Sony getting Spider-Man back completely now, who knows, but yeah. So I'm going to give this a 9 out of 10. It was pretty good. Go out and buy this. It's pretty good. I really enjoyed it. Yeah, so what are your thoughts on Spider-Man Into the Spider-Verse? Let me know in the comments below. Remember to like, share, and subscribe, and I'll see you next time. Had to be one more, didn't there? There just had to be. Had to be one more goddamn yawn. Didn't there? Bye.